So how did you first get involved in studying Chile?
Let's see. Well, I grew up in Houston, Texas. So I grew up traveling with my family to Mexico by car over the border, which has changed considerably. I grew up with a lot of Mexican-American students in my K through 12 classes. So I grew up hearing and speaking a bit of Spanish as a kid. And I grew up in a family that's a kind of lefty family, so particularly for the United States. And I was appealed to by a region where politics are both vibrant and where people who are progressive actually get elected. And you know, that was not necessarily my own family's experience of politics, that were more marginal. So I was very intrigued with a place, a region generally, that had a lot of richness in terms of political mobilization, social movements. I always felt like we in the United States had a lot to learn from Latin America. And Chile particularly was a country that caught a lot of people's interests, particularly the left, because in 1970, the first democratically elected, self-proclaimed Marxist won the presidency. And so a lot of eyes were on Chile in the late 60s and early 70s. And in 1983, during my senior year as an undergraduate in college, I had a very well-known political science professor, a Chilean-American named Arturo Valenzuela, who organized, this was during the 10th year of the dictatorship in Chile, organized a group of graduate students and some undergrads to go. I didn't really want to go because I thought, who wants to go to a country under dictatorship? But he convinced me to go and offered me a small fellowship, and then it was so deeply influential for me being there in 1983, which was a moment that is depicted in a lot of the arpilleras here, a moment of the first real mass protests against dictatorship, when the Chilean economy was suffering, and there were the creation of these common soup kitchens, and a lot of the scenes of, that are portraying the poverty and struggle and collective action around movements for democracy and human rights and an end to the dictatorship. So I was in the country at a moment where there was a lot of protest for the first time. And I came back and I graduated from college and went to work in Washington, D.C. And there I continued working human rights in Chile, then grad school. And so Chile's been very much with me since I was a college student.
Sure. So you mentioned your first visit in Chile came in 1983. As we know, the dictatorship ended in 1990, and you began your field work in 2014. Have you seen the passing of time kind of play a part in your research?
Well, my own field work, before I wrote these articles, my graduate student dissertation in political science was about the Chilean left, the rise and fall and return to democracy, and focusing in on this group of people who had been young people 1970 to 73 period and the end of the democracy and the brutal dictatorship. So I actually returned to Chile in 1989
experience, my next question. How do you think memory, art, and the memorialization in Chile and Latin America honor the victims of Pinochet's dictatorship?
How do I think of memory?
How do you believe that memory, art, and memorialization in Chile and Latin America have honored the victims of Pinochet's dictatorship?
Well, there has been this explosion of memorials, and now museums of memory as well, all over the region. And they've really been led by grassroots groups, families who've lost loved ones, people who've lost political comrades. There's a great deal of interest in representing that period, both representing the costs of the repression in human lives, and also remembering what many of them had fought for in the 60s and 70s for a better world. So particularly from young Chileans today, there's real interest in the group of 60s activists and 70s activists who had this project and lost terribly, including their lives. So you have different kinds of generations involved in wanting to see memorials all over. And in Chile, it's like a huge memorialization process.
Absolutely. In your work teaching the politics of encounter, you credit the 1990 neuroscience discovery of mirror neurons as scientific evidence that empathy is an intrinsic human trait. Do you think the repression of memories, like the trauma of Pinochet's dictatorship, strengthen or weaken the function of these memory neurons?
Interesting. Well, you know, there's a large literature about empathy and a lot of debates when we think about human rights and how we face difficult conversations in politics, whether it's in the United States, when we try to have conversations about racism, for example, which in my view is a country that have failed to do well.
museum guides is being frustrated with the silence of college students at the end of the exhibit.
Yeah.
Silence can infer a lack of understanding or empathy, but it can also be the result of anxiety as students do not want to say anything offensive. You state that the guides in the Museum of Memory and Human Rights stuck to a dry narrative, using the third person to distance themselves from any bias. Do you think the lack of agency of the tour guides is the reason for the silence? Or do you think the self-conscious college students are responsible for the lack of dialogue?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think the Museum of Memory is an official museum, and so the guides intended to stick to a script because they're guiding all kinds of groups through the museum, including groups from very different kinds of politics. They've had to guide military officers through, police officers, so sticking to a script that is very dry about the institutionalization of the dictatorship helps. But they also, you know, there is a room in the museum that depicts the torture that took place. Not, it's super representational terms, but enough. And there are just some very emotionally jarring. When I go to the Museum of Memory, it's not uncommon to see a 14-year-old crying as she's looking at, you know, a letter that a kid wrote to her father who's in prison. So it's a very emotionally evocative space. So the guides, I think, in the Museum of Memory are trying to read the U.S. students, but they're not alone. You know, I also write about how guides in spaces where there are not the scripts also try to engage. And so it was shocking to me in a way to find out that among all of the different guides in places where there's more dialogue or less dialogue, that they all feel the same way, that U.S. students are the most frustrating often to guide through because they can't read how they're responding. And so I don't know that it's, I don't think it's lack of agency on the part of the guides. I think it's more, what would allow us to, I mean, this is where I think my own job becomes really important, because I'm a professor who gets a sense of why the guides might be frustrated, and I also want to defend my U.S. students who are smart and caring and are just struggling to articulate how they feel, because it's a deeply moving space. And sometimes the kind of work has to take place after the visit.
Absolutely.
Students is set, but I don't want to let students off the hook when they're quiet. But I do think, you know, it's an ongoing process of working through very difficult material.
For sure. So Leonardo da Vinci once said, "Tears come from the heart, not the brain." You state that many guides were uncomfortable with the tears of students as they felt guilty for causing the emotional reaction. Other guides did not mind as much as they're more focused on finishing the exhibit than connecting with the students crying. The act of shedding tears can suggest true compassion and an empathetic understanding. Do you think holding back emotion is the appropriate decision as a visiting U.S. student? Is the goal of the American student or tourist to empathize and connect, or to study and debate?
Well, that's an interesting question. I mean, I obviously don't want students to shut down their emotions. And it was revealing that when the guides said it was so hard for them when students cry, it was more about themselves, right? That they felt they caused the tears.
Yeah.
So it wasn't really that they were criticizing the U.S. students. It was that they were feeling bad themselves, right? So I think it would be problematic
United States is a society of deep denial that nonetheless lives the violence of the past atrocities very much in the present. You credit the domestic legacy of genocide and enslavement, as well as imperial involvement, as contributions to our country's violent past. Are reparations to be made through compassion or compensation? Does the burden fall on the students or the teachers of America?
Everyone. Yeah, I mean, I wrote that article that I wrote it in 2014, I think it came out in 2016. I didn't anticipate the last 2 years of our national politics and ways in which it's been a great explosion to an exposure in the United States of violences that I can't help but feel are connected to the past, particularly white supremacist violence, you know, that has been in Charlottesville, has been at the Pittsburgh synagogue, that has taken place in many spaces around the country, and the rise of hate groups, which the Southern Poverty Law Center has documented just recently, a very powerful and disturbing report about this rise of hate groups across the country. So I think it's less denied in a way, or it's more exposed than when I was writing that article, and it makes me feel there's all the more urgency to come to terms with that, to figure out, you know, what the hell, like, why are we in such repression about the connections between slavery, the 13th Amendment, the reproduction of the architecture of slavery through convict leasing in the early 20th century, and into Jim Crow laws, and you know, the kinds of ways it's played out in education and predatory housing. I mean, there's so many ways in which we can trace that the past is not past. And you know, there's great work that's been done on this by Ta-Nehisi Coates and Sadia Hartman and many, many great writers and thinkers about this. And you know, when I teach political science, my intro to political science class as a comparativist is all about how, you know, we're not unique, the United States, in this way completely. We're particularly violent, but we're not unique in terms of the ways in which all countries, all states, start quite violently, because you're basically at war, you're defining territories, you need armies to define your borders, you're coercing people to pay taxes, to pay to feed the army. I mean, it's you know, for centuries it's been a violent process. I grew up in Texas. It's a particularly violent place that we celebrate gun culture. We celebrate this idea that Texas heroes were the frontier cowboys and developed the six-shooter, you know. And that's something we need to unravel and rethink in a big way. So the United States is not completely unique, and yet we really need to face up to the violences, the ways in which violence manifests in here and now.
So, in an article by Guy Lai published on you, they quote, "Silence about Chile's painful past predominates, in good part because Chileans do not like to revisit the confrontations of the past, nor the devised debates over causes and consequences that confronting memory begins. Historians often talk about collective groups of people in a country that retain memory, often sharing common themes as a collective. With the common theme of avoidance of the past in Chile, do you think the repression of memory can be viewed as a collective?"